American Sports Cavalcade. A panorama of speed, color, drama, and excitement. The American Sports Cavalcade.
Few towns in America are more recreation-oriented than Phoenix, Arizona and its surrounding suburbs. Of course, there's golf and more tennis courts per capita than any town in the U.S. and the beloved Sun Devils of Arizona State University. But for those who like their action on the fast side, just 10 miles east towards Tucson is Firebird International Raceway. Hello, everyone. I'm Steve Evans. And as you can probably hear, Firebird Raceway has fired up for NHRA Championship Drag Racing, the third running of the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals, the next to the last race on the year-long Winston Drag Racing Series. Now, in the top fuel eliminator category, all the excitement this year has been generated by two men. Joe Amato from Pennsylvania, Dick LaHaye from Michigan. They have battled head-to-head through 12 races. Dick LaHaye has been in five final rounds. He has won four of those. Now, Joe Amato has only won three events, but he's been in eight final rounds. He has more points. The most crucial race for both drivers came at the granddaddy of them all, the final round of the U.S. Nationals. It was Dick LaHaye a little bit late off the starting line, just enough to allow Joe Amato into the victory circle. Before the action began this weekend, I talked to both men about their chances for a world title.
You know, Steve, coming into this race here, we're 456 points behind. If we need to set low ET or top speed or both, which will accumulate us a couple of, or 100 points on that standpoint, if we could touch the national record, it'd be nice, but I don't think it's going to happen at this racetrack. With the high altitude and the temperature and the low humidity, it's hard to make these cars run as fast as they will in other places. We also need to go a couple rounds ahead of, or finish a couple rounds ahead of Joe so that we can accumulate a few points that way. There's 200 points around, and then that way going into the World Finals, you know, we'll be a little bit closer, and then we can just race head-to-head for it.
Joe, what do you have to do to fend off Dick LaHaye for the overall World Championship? What's your plan?
Well, basically, we're just going to go out and race. You know, it's hard to try and look ahead and second-guess yourself. There's eight rounds of racing left, and we've got to do whatever he does within two rounds of that.
You've been thinking about this.
Oh, yeah, you run it over in your mind. There's no doubt about it. You know, you want to... You know, not make any mistakes, but you know, to try and second guess and qualify funny or do anything like that, you know, you don't want to do any of them things. You want to just go out and race hard and try and win the two races. Then that just eliminates him having a chance. You know, that's our goal.
There's a young man who drives a bright red dragster that could spoil the plans of both the men I just talked to. His name is Daryl Gwynn, and he set the elapsed time record at 5.08 seconds at the Texas Motorplex 2 weeks ago. Neither LaHaye or Amato wants to draw Daryl Gwynn in the early rounds, for very obvious reasons. Well, this young man, Daryl Gwynn, could be the spoiler in this whole deal, Daryl. If Dick LaHaye or Joe Amato meet you, they may very well come out on the losing end. You could determine this thing.
Well, that's true, Steve. As a matter of fact, our performance up these last couple of races is going to mean a lot. You're exactly right when you say spoiler. I could be a spoiler and we could be a winner. We could spoil it for them and we could be a winner at the same time. You know, we do have a shot at the World Championship and we can also spoil it for one of them too. I don't mean to spoil it for them too. I'm the one that's wanting to be on the winning side, but spoiling it for them is what they're worried about.
But it was not meant to be. All the power in the world won't do any good if the transmission is stuck in reverse gear. That's exactly what happened to Daryl Gwynn earlier today in Top Fuel Dragster round number one action. The crew frantically rocked the car back and forth, could not get it in the forward gear, and that gave Larry Miner a bye run. He automatically advances to round number two. Now, that was all earlier today. Now, for more on earlier action here at Firebird, here's Paul Page.
Well, Steve, in Top Fuel qualifying, Gene Snow provided some real excitement in more than one way. First of all, for a while, he was the number one qualifier. And it was a result of this particular run right here. Now, watch very carefully at the back of the car as, boom, just before he gets to the line, the engine lets go, the blower belt flies through the air. But still, Gene Snow, with that run, was the number one qualifier. Now, look at it again. Look, the fire and flame as the oil burns away at the back back of the machine, and Gene Snow goes on safely into the shutdown area. Here it is, just one more time. Gene Snow, with this run, became the number one qualifier, and I think everyone was surprised about that, not the least of which was Gene Snow. You see the car now rolling to a stop, and at the end, Gene Snow really expressed his surprise.
525 for low qualifier, but a little noisy.
Yeah, we should have been running a 1,000-foot track, I think.
What do you think? That's no problem for you.
It's called O2 lean. No, we just get a little bit richer. It'd be all right.
Got to be happy with the run.
Yeah, I didn't know it was going to do that good. It quit at about 1,100 feet.
No kidding.
Yeah, slapped me in the head a little bit. It's all right.
Go back, new motor, I'm ready to go.
Oh, yeah, maybe we'll just put a blower on it.
All right, thank you.
Okay.
But his position didn't last. When Joe Amato ran shortly thereafter, he became the number one qualifier with a 5.24. Now, also today, we're going to be looking at the top alcohol funny cars. And there, Pat Austin, already the world champion, is the number one qualifier. In addition, we'll be visiting again with Pro Stock, where Bob Glidden was the top qualifier, continuing his unprecedented streak in that position.
Well, now, we mentioned that we're going to be seeing alcohol funny cars, so let's take a look at Pat Austin's machine here. Now, externally, it looks a great deal like the funny cars that are running nitro. And when we lift the body off of it and take a look inside, again, it looks very much the same. In fact, this engine is actually larger than the funny car that burns the nitro fuel. Of course, we're talking alcohol all the way through the system here. They can go up to 557 cubic inches. This one happens to be 525. A nitro-powered car would be a 500 cubic inch engine. In the gearbox department, a little change there, too. The funny car nitro-powered would run two speeds. This is a three-speed machine. But, of course, these provide some incredible excitement. Steve?
Thank you, Paul. The largest crowd in the history of this four-year-old facility has jammed the grandstands for the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals. And it's a perfect day. Temperature about 85 degrees, humidity 20%. It just couldn't be any nicer. And now it's time for round number one of Top Alcohol Funny Car. There is the Trans Am body car of Lou Gasparelli. Gasparelli glides into the water, then hammers the throttle in high gear to smoke those tires. As most of you know, that's called a burnout. The fans love them. And here's his opponent, Art Hindy. Now, Hindy is having the best day ever in his drag racing career. He's qualified in the fourth position. Gasparelli was qualified eighth.
Gasparelli came in with a 6:45.219 to Art Hindy's 6:37.223. These are really hot little machines, the top alcohol funny cars.
They are indeed. Lou Gasparelli, a former Winter Nationals champion. He's from Monrovia, California, just east of Los Angeles. Art Hindy, well, he's a little further east of Los Angeles. This car and team is based in San Bernardino, California.
You take a look at Art Hindy in the picture, it doesn't tell you how really tall he is. He's a giant of a man. I'd say about 6'5", and he really has to scrunch down to climb into this top alcohol funny car.
And this car of Hindy's, Paul, has got a few seasons on it. You can see the windows are not completely enclosed like the later model cars. The front end it shows the design of a couple of years ago. But apparently the car doesn't seem to know that because he has qualified four positions higher than Gasparelli. Gasparelli, who generally is at the top of the pack, may have his hands full with this fellow from San Bernardino as they move up the stage. I stand corrected. Gasparelli is not using a Trans Am body. This beautiful new car has a Topaz fiberglass replica shell. As they move up the stage, Hindy is already in waiting for Gasparelli. Hindy makes the final move, positioned exactly on the starting line. The pro start of the Christmas tree, and Hindy with a wonderful hole shot. Art Hindy reacted perfectly to the greenery. Gasparelli was not his usual self off the starting line and just shuts it off. He knew this one was over, Paul.
Art Hindy with a 641, 221 miles an hour to a losing 718, 150 miles an hour. Hindy got the hole shot there.
All right, here's the second pair in round one of top alcohol funny cars. This will be the machine of Richard Hartman against Pat Austin. Now, Austin is really a force to be reckoned with. In fact, he has already been crowned the world champion in this category. And there again, a good shot of that thundering, smoky burnout. And it's up to the crews at the starting line to back these cars up at exactly the tracks they burn out in, or that whole effort is worthless. All right, while this pair is backing up and getting ready, let's go down to the far end of the racetrack and Paul Payne.
All right, Gasparelli shut down early on that one.
I guess I was ahead of him, so he decided to shut down.
6:41, though, that's equals best time of this session, sir.
Not too bad, huh? We were hoping for the low 30s.
What's slowing it down?
Just the air. The air went away.
So awful hot today.
Yeah, really bad. It was like 97 degrees.
Any changes going to the next round?
No, we're just going to tune it up a little bit. You know, use a Chuck Worsham tune-up, and that's about it.
You're looking good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chuck Worsham, the crew chief on that car, and there is Lou Gasparilli coming in to offer his congratulations. All right, here we go. Back behind the starting line now, the Richard Hartman Corvette-bodied funny car. The car over there is Virgil Hartman. And, of course, the driver is Richard Hartman, a 20-year-old machinist from Laverne, California. He will be facing in this round the already world champion from Tacoma, Washington, the family team of 22-year-old Pat Austin.
Austin, one of those second-generation drivers, Paul, who is just destined to drag race. His father before him did. In fact, now tunes this car. His uncle, Bucky Austin, a very well-known drag racer out of the Northwest. Here's Richard Hartman, just 20 years of age. If he could defeat Pat Austin, that would be the biggest win of his still young career.
You know, one thing we see in these alcohol-powered cars, unlike the top fuel cars that we'll be seeing a little bit later, is they bring the revs up plenty early on the starting line.
That's right. Tremendous RPM off the line. They don't have all of that horsepower. They don't have 3,000 horsepower to launch the car, so they do it with a lot of torque multiplication. And, of course, they're busier in the cockpit, too, because they make an extra gear change. Far lane, Richard Hartman. Near lane, moving in is Pat Austin. The flash of yellow, then green, and Hartman having some problems. The young man shuts it off, and Pat Austin hammers it through with a 6.34. That's the kind of time you heard Hendy ask for a little earlier on, and a big speed for an alcohol car, 221 miles per hour. So Pat Austin, to really no one's surprise, moves into round number two here at Firebird. Two more races to come in this round of Top Alcohol Funny Car. We'll have that and more when we come back.
American Sports Cavalcade, brought to you by Dodge. America's best back trucks are Ram Tough. By Stroh's and Strohlite. Now you're talking good times, and Stroh's is spoken here. And by Sure Antiperspirant. Now Sure's available in a new Desert Spice scent.
You're about to experience a whole new feeling. New Sure with Desert Spice scent. If you'll go with the feeling, it'll add new spice to your life.
If you're looking for the only mid-size pickup in America, with the heart of a full-size and the spirit of a compact, with available new V6 fuel injection up front, room in back for a full sheet of plywood, and covered by the best truck warranty in the business, it's gotta be the mid-size Dodge Dakota.
It's gotta be a Dodge!
Yes, Mrs. Ferber, I'll be right over.
What's up?
It's Alex. He's been burying things in Mrs. Ferber's garden again.
Right here. Mm-hmm. Alex, a bottle of Stroh's.
Keep digging.
Mm-hmm. Nice, Alex. 15 packs.
Keep digging.
With Stroh's and Strohlite 15 and 30 packs, you get more beer.
How did he get a whole truck down there?
Why don't we ask the driver?
If your car is trying to tell you it wants something, come to Kmart and get dual-beam GE halogen headlamps for improved visibility.
Nice car.
Want some more?
Kmart, America's favorite store.
Here's to the winners, those who move mountains. Here's to the miracles they make us see.
Holiday Inn welcomes you, the people who know that winning at life is working hard at it and living it fully day after day.
Here's to the winners, all of us can be.
Holiday Inn salutes you. Here's to the winners. We're on your way.
We're back at the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals in Phoenix, Arizona. I'm Steve Evans along with Paul Page. And that machine right there, driven by Brad Anderson, is one of the toughest alcohol funny cars in the world. He won this year's U.S. Nationals, and everyone will tell you that Anderson, as far as engineering parts, pieces, building motors, is the tops in his field. In fact, he supplies a lot of engines for other drivers in the category. He'll be racing Terry Mullins, but first let's go to Paul.
Pat Austin, already the world champion, 6:34 here, though. That's a nice quick run. Best of that round.
Yeah, we're impressed with the way the car's running. My dad came in and set it up, and it came out of the trailer and ran real good, and he's just picked up ever since.
And a lot of the guys are coming in here complaining about the heat. Is it affecting you?
Yeah, it affects the car, as far as the car or the driver.
Either one.
The driver hasn't affected me at all, because when we were in Florida here 3 or 4 weeks ago, it was like this hot, but 90% humidity. And that's when it bothers me, all sweaty and grimy. But here, It affects the performance of the cars a little bit, as you can tell, because they're a little slower than, you know, like, say, the Motorplex, but also the track is a little different, too, so it does affect the cars.
What you learned this round, are you going to dial anything new in?
I don't think so. I think we're pretty close. I don't think we want to go ahead and overpower the track or anything and get in trouble. We're okay right now.
All right, you need to get back. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, here is Brad Anderson going to do that dry burnout right there to heat up the clutch. Anderson from Covina, California. He's 47 years of age. Had a horrible accident a couple of years ago. Everybody said, well, he's done. He ordered a new car from the intensive care ward. He's going up against Terry Mullins, Paul.
A 33-year-old manufacturer from Oak Ridge, Tennessee. He drives an 87 Firenze. Top alcohol funny car from Phoenix, Arizona. Anderson on the near side, Mullins on the far side.
It's interesting, the top alcohol funny car actually costs more to build than its big brother, the Nitro Machine, but it's far more economical to campaign. It just doesn't break as many pieces, and the fuel is far cheaper. Now, Brad Anderson, he's very content to stay in this category. This is home for him, but a youngster like Pat Austin, well, I think he's got aspirations of moving up into that 3,000-horsepower world.
You know, you mentioned the cost of the category. A couple of the drivers back in the hot pits also said while it's cheaper, the purses are also smaller.
Oh, boy. Terry Mullins moving in on the far right. They're staged and ready. A flash of yellow and getting sideways and up the pedal is Terry Mullins. Brad Anderson gets a big break here because Mullins had the whole shot. He was off the mark first until handling problems set in. A 6:44. Brad will not be happy with that. 218 miles per hour.
And Mullins got a real good look at the wall, decided it was just a little bit too close.
So the body being latched down and the windshield being cleaned on the Black Thunder car. It is driven by Buster Chandler. And as you can see on that rear tire, there's a big white stripe across it. Well, that's so the crew, either by eyesight or videotape, can tell how much tire slippage there is off of the starting line. That's just kind of an indicator. Now, he's going to be over in the far lane, and he may have some concerns about that lane after watching the handling problems that Terry Mullins has had. So far, that has not been a particularly good side of the racetrack. His opponent will be Chuck Beal, also a former Winter Nationals champion, finished number 8 in the world last year. Right now, let's go to Paul, who's with Brad Anderson.
Thank you.
Brad, 6:44, 2:18 as the competition shuts down.
6:44? Mm-hmm. Ooh, not very good. We better go do some homework.
Is that happening off the track and the heat we're feeling today?
No, I just made a whole bunch of changes. We worked real late last night trying some stuff, and evidently it didn't work. So.
Change it back.
We better do that right away.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, I told you Brad Anderson wouldn't be happy with that run. If he's not in the 30s or even the 20s on some tracks, he doesn't consider it a good day. Here is Chuck Beal. You just saw him lower the emergency roof hatch there. That's the only way they can get any ventilation in these cars now.
Top alcohol funny car, this is an 86 Camaro. Chuck Beal, the driver, a 44-year-old quality engineer from San Diego, California. He faces Buster Chandler, 36 years old, from Audbury, Texas.
And Buster's got a Mustang body on his Black Thunder car, so it's kind of Ford versus Chevrolet in the body department anyway. But under the hood, you can bet they both got very potent supercharged Hemi power.
I think that's a point, that when you strip the fiberglass off of these, you're really talking virtually identical machines in almost all cases. Change of motor, but really the same car.
And the category is really a driver's eliminator. So often these races are won by the first man off the starting line. Here today, the racing hasn't been that close. That's unusual, and it may be because of track conditions. Well, the last stage is going to be Buster Chandler. He's really taking his time. Finally, they're in, and away first is Buster Chandler, and he is sideways in that far lane. Buster Chandler got out of the racing groove and almost crossed the center line. Chuck Beal at 6.54 seconds, 212 miles per hour, will advance to the semifinals. And as we compile the pairings, we'll show you a pretty sight. Tonto National Forest, just about a 45-minute drive from the racetrack, the scenic wonders of Arizona. All right, here is the semifinal pairings. Chuck Beal versus Pat Austin. Austin has lane choice, the only one of the semi-drivers in the 6:30 elapsed time range. Art Hindy will race Brad Anderson, and Hindy has lane choice. That's a bit of a surprise. Few people ever outrun Brad Anderson for lane choice. Let's again go to Paul.
Well, Chuck, they shut down against you, so you're a 6:54, 2:12.
Well, that's not good enough, but we're going to work on it between rounds.
Yeah, you're slowing down just a bit.
Yeah, we changed blowers this round and changed the clutch all around, and I just don't know what we're doing wrong here.
Serious head scratching going to go on.
You bet, right now.
All right, see you later.
Thank you very much, sir.
Sometimes it just seems these cars have a mind of their own. Well, on the starting line, some serious thunder about to begin. The second round of Top Fuel Eliminator. Gary Ormsby strapped in and ready for his encounter. We'll be back with that right after this.
I'll get it, Alex.
Mel's Market. Here's your order.
What order?
Side of beef.
I didn't order.
Here's your delivery, sir.
What delivery?
Your Stroh's 30 packs.
Stroh's. Alex?
Nah.
Stroh's and Stroh Light. Fire brewed for smooth, consistent taste. And with 30 packs, you get more beer.
Pardon. Bier Spetschup. Here's your poodle. Oh.
Alex.
Everyone's going ape in October with the biggest hit music from country's brightest stars. Bust Loose with the O'Kanes, nominated for 4 Country Music Awards and featuring 3 top 10 singles. Turn on hit after hit with Ricky Van Shelton's monster debut album, Wild Eye Dream. And hold on tight for 5 smash singles from Sweethearts of the Rodeo.
No diet in the world will help you lose weight until you do one thing, control your appetite.
I struggled to lose weight for a year. Then I took Dexatrim. Now the weight's gone and I'm the size I want to be.
Dexatrim is amazing. I lost the weight I wanted without being hungry.
Dexatrim. You can't buy a stronger appetite control formula without a prescription. Just one capsule works all day to help you lose weight.
You lose weight and you're not even hungry.
Dexatrim. Nothing works harder to help you lose weight.
Today's small cars are tougher than ever on oil. Their high-compression engines not only rev high, they can run hotter than regular small car engines. Their searing heat can begin to break down an oil immediately. That's why there's Castrol, the only leading motor oil that in every grade provides maximum protection against viscosity and thermal breakdown. So use Castrol before your engine does something to get you heated up. Castrol, engineered for today's smaller cars.
We're back at Firebird Raceway for the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals. I'm Paul Page with Steve Evans in Phoenix, Arizona. We're in the second round now of Top Fuel as Larry Miner is ready to face Gary Ormsby.
Gary Ormsby, Paul, has had a satisfying season. He did not run all of the races, but he won the Summer Nationals in New Jersey. He was runner-up just a few weeks ago at the Keystone Nationals in Maple Grove, Pennsylvania. Now, Larry Miner owns just a huge racing team, not only drag racing, but off-road racing and a number of other things. And Miner only runs selected events during the year. And, of course, he is also the team owner for the Dick LaHaye effort and is really here hoping to maybe eliminate some of the tougher customers to try to get him out of LaHaye's way, a blocker, if you will.
Well, we saw him already really in that role, though the problem was Darrell Gwenn's when the machine wouldn't back up. And with that, you saw it in the open of the show, it gave Miner this position as he faces Ormsby.
Now, Gary Ormsby last year got a lot of press with a streamlined automobile, but not very many wind lights. Now a conventional car for the automobile dealer from Roseville, California. Larry Miner and his famous family in Hemet, California are the world's largest potato farmers. But spuds are not on his mind right now as he settles into the narrow confines of that Top Fuel dragster. The crew coming over to take a look at the oil pressure and the water temperature. Important to get these things just to the right temperature where they're not so hot that they make more horsepower than you can use and not so cool that they don't respond to the throttle.
Gary Ormsby over on the far side made it to this round when he beat Dan Pastorini in first round. Now, as Steve, you've already mentioned, he's an experimenter. They like to try new things, the Streamliner just being one of them.
That's right. His crew chief, Lee Beard, one of the best in the business and a man who never stays stagnant. He's always trying to go forward. Miner in the near lane. Oh, and look at Miner. Straight up in the air goes the Larry Miner car, also leaving a red light in his wake. Gary Ormsby at 622, 154 miles per hour. Ormsby, I don't know, Paul, whether he was trying to save his equipment there, seeing the red light, or if he was also experiencing some difficulties. But let's take a look one more time. Watch the car in the near lane. The front wheels don't roll 2 inches before they go straight up in the air. Larry Miner tried to fly that car much like it would an airplane. It got on the wheelie bars, which he uses, and that kept it from going over backwards. Maybe the only thing that did. So Gary Ormsby now has a berth in the semifinals.
Larry Miner's red light and a wheel stand gives you the win. Did you see any of it?
I saw the wheel stand. I knew I was either terribly late or he had red lit. I didn't actually see it when I went by. And it appears we had a little luck because we lost the blower belt on that run.
So just shut her down or you
no,
lost the belt?
No, it shut itself off. It shut itself off.
A lot of luck, I'd say.
Well, you need some of those once in a while.
Thanks, Gary.
Well, often something happens inside the supercharger engine to cause that belt to slip off. And you can see as they rotate the pulley on the top of the supercharger, it's no longer there. Gene Snow and Eddie Hill will be our next pair. And their cars, like all of them, use virtually the same type of engine. It's a pushrod Hemi motor. But there's another team going a different direction. Earlier, Paul Page filed this report.
Well, here's a man who's no stranger, Steve, to our Diamond P broadcast. He is none other than two-time world champion Gary Beck, who's doing a little bit of test piloting now as you make a bit of a comeback here.
Well, that's right, Paul. I've gotten involved with a project this year with Chris and Phil McGee, and it's been very interesting. I've learned a lot over the last year with it. It's, another engine built for drag racing, but it's a very unique one.
What are your plans with it? You going to test it some more?
Yes, I am. We ran it here in Phoenix, and we're planning on running at the World Finals out in Pomona, and, it's starting to show some power for us, and we're hoping to get it into the show. Maybe we'll beat somebody with it.
Let's talk about the motor itself. It's a McGee. It's something that I'm a little more accustomed to in like IndyCar pits, and that we're looking at two cams on either side. Can you go through it?
Well, it's a dual overhead cam, four-valve per cylinder engine, and what that accomplishes is a lot more airflow through the heads, and so you can get more fuel into the engine. Theoretically, you can build a lot more horsepower. It's still a 500 cubic inch engine, just like everybody else has got, but just the overall airflow and fuel ratios make more horsepower.
Well, Steve, it's a grand old name, Gary Beck, and a brand new engine. Let's hope the combination shows some great performance.
Well, the McGees couldn't have found a better man than Gary Beck to help them develop that new power plant. Gene Snow, one of the quickest in the world. He also ran a 5.08 2 weeks ago at the Texas Motorplex. A former car dealer, now a Wildcat oil driller, Gene Snow. How about Eddie Hill? He's been around this sport a long time. He was the quickest in drag boats. Well, now he's the fastest on land. At 285 miles per hour, the Texan holds the official NHRA record for speed.
In the far lane, then, it is Eddie Hill, that beautiful white Texan. Gene Snow, also a white machine, enters up to the line now on the near side.
Gene Snow won this very race 2 years ago, the inaugural, and Eddie Hill has been runner-up two times this season. He's knocking on the door, making his first national event win here. A great start by both drivers, Eddie Hill and Gene Snow. It is the Texan. Percy Hill sees the wet light and loves it. Eddie Hill at 5:58, 263 miles per hour over Gene Snow. So that'll put the Texan in the semifinal round. Let's look at it one more time. Doesn't appear that either driver haven't had an advantage right off of the starting line. Gene Snow just dangling those front wheels. Both he and Eddie Hill like the small Don Garland-style front rubber. And here, going towards the finish line, a little wisp of smoke off the engine of Eddie Hill. But that didn't seem to rob it of much power. Hill wins by a car length.
Eddie, a 5:58 with a 263.
Well, we must have been kind of loose out in the mid-range, I guess. Came on pretty hard, felt like, down at this end, but I was looking at the back of Snowman's car, seemed like, till at least half track.
Halfway down, it looked like he had you.
Yeah, I thought it was all over, and the top-end charge just kind of came through that time, I guess, or else maybe Snow broke something. But anyway, feels good to get to another round. Thank you.
Eddie misses those big speeds, you can just tell. Well, here is one of the key players as far as this year's Winston World Championship is concerned. We will now see Joe Amato versus Jack Ostrander. Ostrander, the guzzler car from Michigan. He's a bartender by trade. Joe Amato, of course, offers a very successful wholesale auto parts and speed equipment business in Old Forge, Pennsylvania. There's a good look at Ostrander's car, the nicest machine that he has ever fielded. In fact, Paul, this year he's gotten more win lights than I think he has in his career collectively. Of course, Amato, just a few hundred points ahead of Dick LeHaye for that world championship, and he'll be the first to tell you the brains behind that outfit is Tim Richards, his crew chief, and really the team manager. Amato says, when I come to the races, even though I sign his paycheck, at the racetrack, I work for him.
As we take a look at Ostrander, he is in the far lane. It is the lane that has been causing the most problem throughout the weekend. And given lane choice, I think everybody would like to be in the near lane. And there, of course, sits the former world champion, Joe Amato, who is looking for yet another world champion.
Of course, lane choice is determined by the quicker ET from the previous round. Amato ran quicker than Ostrander in round one, so he picks, as just about everybody has, the near lane. So they move into stage. Don't you know Dick LeHaye would like to see Amato defeated here?
Lesnar, and there hangs in the first half of the track, but it is not to be. Joe Amato goes to the semis at 5:36, a good solid number, 272 miles per hour. And let's give some credit to Jack Ostrander. He gave it everything he had at 5:59, 259 miles per hour. Everybody up, excited, having a good time on a beautiful day. More Top Fuel action coming our way right after these words. Stay with us. We'll be back to Phoenix.
Do you love Rose Cox? The gear-banging, 7-second, 190-mile-an-hour excitement only they can bring? Then whatever you do, now's the time to order Hot Rods from Detroit. You'll get it all in this new home video from Diamond V, the whole package. The class's four top guns, Bob Glidden, Warren Johnson, Butch Leal, and Bruce Allen, grab your mind, hold it tight, and launch you into the ultimate pro stock experience. And what it's like to race the most technically sophisticated, difficult-to-drive cars in all of drag racing. Meet the coming stars, plus the greatest from the past who helped build the class. All this and more in one sizzling feature-length home video package. And as a special bonus, we'll send you a Motorcraft quality parts cap, just like the one worn by world champion Bob Glidden and his crew. To order now, call 1-800-292-1100. Just $39.95 plus $3.50 shipping and handling. Dial 1-800-292-1100 or send a check or money order to this address. Visa or MasterCard accepted. Call now.
Saturday, November 7th, you'll laugh along with syndicated columnist, author, and humorist Louis Brizard in a comedy concert.
When I was in Chicago, they used to say, do people read? Do you wear shoes? I don't know how stupid Southerners are, but I ain't never seen no Southerner pay to go inside no reptile farm. Have you?
Get set for a laugh-filled evening with Louis Brizard. Saturday, November 7th at 9 Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific on TNN.
Auto Week makes racing come alive every week. Feel the excitement. Formula One, sports cars, stockers, Indy cars. Auto Week brings it home fast, days after the race, with columnists who race and win. Auto Week makes street cars come alive with road tests that put you inside the hottest cars. In-depth features, cars of the past, industry news, personality profiles, the best classified anywhere. Get the excitement of Auto Week every week. Call 1-800-331-1000 for a year's subscription. 52 issues for the basic rate of $23, just 44 cents a week. Call now and get this racing decal shirt free. That's 1-800-331-1000. Operators are standing by. Auto Week, it makes cars come alive.
We're back at Firebird International Raceway, a few miles east of Phoenix, Arizona, the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals. Pit work going on for top alcohol funny car standout Pat Austin, his father putting the finishing touches on that car. Right now, let's go to the far end at Paul Page.
When Joe Amato continues that march onto a world championship with a 5:36.272.
That was a good run. The heat has come in a little bit, so I'm happy to run in the 30s. It'll be interesting to see what Dick LaHaye runs now for lane choice, because it's going to be critical. The next round is going to be really a dogfight here.
The way the heat's building up on the track here today, what difference is that going to make by final round?
Well, it'll cool off by final round. The next round for us is the final round, because we're tied in a battle, 458 points ahead of LaHaye. So if we win the next round, that'll really put the icing on the cake for the championship. If we lose, it'll probably come down to the last race. So it's really critical for us. My true chief, Tim Richards, is going to have to step it up and, you know, do a good job, and that'll put the pressure on Joe Amato to drive good, and hopefully I can fulfill that.
Absolutely. Good luck.
Thank you.
Well, I couldn't agree with Joe more. The semifinal confrontation between he and LaHaye, if LaHaye gets that far, could be the whole season. Now, this man may have something to say about that. That is Connie Coletta, Ypsilanti, Michigan. Not only is the pilot of a Top Fuel director, but he's got his own Air Force, Coletta's Flying Services. Dick LaHaye, he is a professional drag racer. Through thick and thin, the man never quit. Of course, his daughter, Kim, is the crew chief. His son also involved in running the car. Truly a family operation. But there, another family operation has got big problems. Lots of oily-looking smoke pouring from the car of Connie Coletta. It also appears to have some transmission problems. And it looks like Coletta may give Dick LaHaye a gift here. Yes, it's all over with. They tell him, get it off the racetrack.
So Connie Coletta rolls off down the racetrack. It'll be a bye run for Dick LaHaye, but don't make any mistake. That doesn't mean it's going to be a calm run, because LaHaye wants to run as hard as he can to get a fast ET so that he can potentially get lane choice against Amato.
That's right, and the number he has to beat is 5.36. He's got to run quicker than that to get lane choice. So LaHaye does have an opponent here. It's that clock in the timing tower here at Firebird. The crew intently looking on. You can see Kim in the background. She's looking at all the header points to see if the engine is dropping any cylinders. Up he rolls. This is as pressure-packed as if there was a car in that opposite lane, because this racetrack appears to be not a two-lane facility. It appears the near lane has tremendous tracks and the far lane is marginal. There's LaHaye. He's on a great run. The front wheel, he gets a little sideways half-track. He has done it. Dick LaHaye will have the lane choice. 5.31, 273 miles per hour. LaHaye will meet Amato, but LaHaye has lane choice in his corner. As we look across the valley again at the beautiful mountains in the Tonto National Forest, we see that LaHaye has lane choice over Amato in the semifinal. The other pairing will pit Eddie Hill against Gary Ormsby, and here it is Eddie Hill who will have the lane choice. So if the fans came here to see a LaHaye-Amato confrontation, they're going to get it in the semifinals.
I'll tell you what, Paul, this has been a terrible weekend for us, but it looks like it's starting to fall together.
We've eating run, way on the nerves, isn't it?
Yeah, we've run 2 5-31s back-to-back, and a lot of prayer has went into this. I just thank the Lord that we got a lane choice.
You're staying right there with him.
Well, I sure hope so.
Might be a world championship.
Boy, this could tell it, couldn't it?
All right.
Well, you can tell by the exhaustion on the face of Dick LaHaye that the temperature has indeed risen. He's handed some refreshments, and right now you know what's going through his mind. What do I do to this automobile to beat Joe Amato? Already back in the pit area, Tim Richards and crew going to work on this car. They know they don't have lane choice. They cannot go to the starting line with too much power. They have got to find a perfect balance. Right now it is time for Pro Stock, the factory hot rods, and this is where all of the Detroit factories go head-to-head. There's Oldsmobile, there's Fords, there's Chevrolets, there's Trans Ams. In fact, speaking of Trans Ams, there is Butch Leal in the near lane, the Pontiac automobile. He will be up against Larry Morgan in an Oldsmobile.
Pro Stock, one of the most evenly matched categories in NHRA drag racing. We look at the Forenza, an 87 of Larry Morgan. Morgan is part of this battle of the state of Ohio. He comes from Newark, Ohio, and he faces one of the best readers of the light in the business, Butch Leal from Blacklick, in his 87 Trans Am.
Now, the Pro Stock cars, Paul, as you well know, all weigh 2,350 pounds with the drivers on board. They're 500 cubic inch engines. There's no nitro or alcohol. This is racing gasoline, 2 4-barrel carburetors. They use a 4-speed transmission. They've got to bang those gears. Leal in the near lane in the Trans Am. The Oldsmobile is Larry Morgan. And away first is Butch Leal. A nice hole shot for Leal. Morgan has something to love. Triumphs here at 7:59, 184 miles per hour. Larry Morgan shuts it off. And of course, Butch Leal led the world championship points early on in the season until Bob Glidden got his act together.
Now here is Bruce Allen in his Chevrolet Beretta as he's ready to face Warren Johnson. The Beretta now becoming a very popular body style. Earlier, Steve took a look at another such Beretta.
This is the fastest and quickest Beretta Pro Stock in all of drag racing, and it's driven by a tall, very athletic guy named Joe Lapone Jr. Now, Joe's a tough competitor. That's obvious by his win record, but he's also a guy who likes to have a lot of fun. He's always loose and cool and wearing shorts. The first thing he does after the first qualifying run at any event he goes to is to thank all the volunteers at the end of the racetrack, the guys that pick up the parachutes and clean up the oil. Nobody thanks him, really, but Joe Lapone in some cases, and he always salutes him as he's leaving with a honk of the horn, the only Pro Stock car I know of that even has a horn on it. Lapone thinks it's fun. Now, if he should have a tough competitor, let's say Bob Glidden gets out in front of him, well, Lapone has a secret switch here. I'm not sure if the tech guys know about this. It's called warp drive. And if warp drive is not enough, well, he just takes a little sweet revenge along with his losing time ticket. And Joe says that all of this stuff just keeps him loose, and it must work because he's one of the best drivers off the starting line in the class.
Back at the line, Warren Johnson with a dry burnout. Now, that helps him find out what the tires are going to do when they have to grab on this concrete pad, and also is the clutch set correctly. So as he moves up, getting ready to go, it is Warren Johnson against Bruce Allen.
Warren Johnson from Duluth, Georgia, started out the season with a bang. He won the opening race, the Winter Nationals, and has not seen the winner single since. Bruce Allen, well, the Beretta has kind of changed his life, Paul. This car is really flying, and his driving lately has been as good as anybody's. The famed Rare and Morrison team out of Arlington, Texas. So it is Oldsmobile versus Beretta, a pair of GM products. Warren Johnson, the silver and black car in the near lane. You can see starter Buster Katz watching this intently. Sometimes they'll play some head games in Pro Soccer Z stage, but not here. Both drivers go in cleanly. It's time for the start here in Pro Stock, and it's a beautiful lead by both drivers. Warren Johnson in the near lane, Bruce Allen in the far lane. Allen appears to have it. Here comes Johnson. It is Johnson by about half a car length. Warren Johnson will go to the semis at 7.59, 183 miles per hour. Bruce Allen close, but not enough. 7.63, 182. Now in replay, if we can look here, yes, it is Warren Johnson who moves first just by a couple of hundredths of a second. Now watch Bruce Allen in the far lane. He appeared, oh, there you see it. It looked like the right tire got a little bit out of the groove, caused him some traction problems, and that possibly cost him the race. It appeared at that point that Bruce Allen had surged in front, but here from behind is the Olds.
Warren, 7.59.
Well, Bush went at 7.59, so I guess we're about equal on performance. I shook the tires real bad, so it wasn't a real good run for us, but a 59, I'll settle for that as long as we won.
All right. Out there.
Thank you.
Well, Warren Johnson ambles to the rear of the car to wrap up the parachute. Already, I'm sure his engineer brain is thinking, what am I going to do to run better? Bruce Allen, as he always does, steps in to congratulate the winner. Well, the thrash continues in the pit of Eddie Hill as he gets ready for the semifinals in Top Fuel. But we've got more Pro Stocks coming up.
Today's small cars are tougher than ever on oil. Their high-compression engines not only rev high, they can run hotter than regular small car engines. Their searing heat can begin to break down an oil immediately. That's why there's Castrol, the only leading motor oil that in every grade provides maximum protection against viscosity and thermal breakdown. So use Castrol before your engine does something to get you heated up. Castrol, engineered for today's smaller cars.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Time Life Music presents the greatest collection of Christmas songs ever assembled.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire.
Now, for the first time, Time Life Music brings you all these great stars together in one Christmas collection. 50 timeless classics on three records, two long play cassettes, and now on two compact discs.
Have a holly jolly Christmas.
Time Life brings you Bing Crosby's White Christmas, the most popular recording of all time. The Treasury of Christmas, the perfect way to celebrate the joy of this holiday season. 50 songs, three records, two long play cassettes, just $19.95. And now for the first time on two compact discs, just $26.95.
To order the Time Life Treasury of Christmas, use your credit card and call 1-800-352-2300. If busy, call 1-800-453-2600. Or send $19.95 for LPs or cassettes, or $26.95 for compact discs to Time Life Christmas, Department 110, Richmond, Virginia.
Back in Phoenix, Arizona, in the 3 days of this Castrol GTX Fall Nationals, over 41,000 people have enjoyed their NHRA drag racing. We continue in Pro Stock as Daryl Alderman is ready to face Jerry Ekman.
You know, Paul, the funny cars are kind of getting bizarre looking as far as bodies is concerned. There's some new rules for next season to correct that. But the rules are very strict for the Pro Stock cars. Other than that giant hood scoop you see there, they have got to be the exact dimensions of the production car that they represent. And in this case, we have got a pair of Camaros going head-to-head. Now, Jerry Ekman has already won a race this season. In fact, it was his first, the Summer Nationals in Englishtown, New Jersey. From Ventura, California, Bill Orndorff owns the car. Now, that smiling face, Daryl Alderman, Fairfield, Illinois. All of the drivers will tell you, Paul, he's probably the finest new driver to come along in the past few seasons. He has just got so much natural ability. Let's see how the staging process goes here. That's Ekman in the far lane. He's anxious to get underway here. He is pre-stage waiting for Alderman. Alderman pre-stage. Now they both move forward a few more inches and the race is underway. The perfect example of the hole shot. Alderman, 7.58. Quicker was Jerry Ekman at 7.57, but Alderman left 0.04 of a second earlier.
Take a look at the car on the left-hand side of your screen. You see how the front end came up early. He knew exactly how to read that light. In fact, they say they can see it as it comes on, goes full bright, and goes off. Daryl Alderman read the light perfectly. As they go to the end of the quarter mile, Alderman's whole shot carries him all the way down with that 7.58 at 183 miles an hour.
And I'll bet neither driver knew for sure who won that race. Well, there he is, the big red Ford Thunderbird of Bob Clinton. He will be up against here, Kenny Delco. Kenny is driving a Firebird, and he, in round number one, defeated Dempsey Hardy. The team is based in Center Reach, New York. And, of course, Bob Glidden has virtually clinched his eighth NHRA Pro Stock World Championship. He has faltered a little bit early in the year, but has now come on strong. In round number one, he beat that fun-loving Beretta of Joe LePone. There is only one Ford in the field, and it is the dominant car. You'd think somebody else could come along and campaign one successfully. Well, not so. Bob Glidden, the only one that has figured out that Ford heavy shotgun motor. And off the mark first is Kenny Delco. Bob Glidden gave away 200s off the line, but his incredible horsepower pulls it out easily. A 7.53, 186. To just 7.73, 181 for the Trans Am of Kenny Delco. Okay, here are the pairings for the semifinals of Pro Stock as we look at the Saguaro cactus, indigenous to the American Southwest. This one just a few yards from the racetrack, actually. Bob Glidden has lane choice over Daryl Alderman. The other half of the Pro Stock semifinals, well, there we'll find Butch Leal with lane choice over Warren Johnson. That'll be Trans Am versus Oldsmobile Firenza. Well, the amazing Bob Glidden has scrambled out of his Thunderbird, and he's ready to talk to Paul.
Bobby, a 7.53, 186 on a real hot day in Arizona.
Yeah, Paul, the track is, because of the heat, I think we're getting a little oil through the track, and it's a little bit loose. All the Pro Stock cars are having just a little bit of wheel hop trouble, 150 foot off the starting line.
All righty, you got to get back and get her going.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bob Glidden well on his way to his fourth consecutive victory this season, sixth in all. Well, here you see the beautiful Firebird International Raceway, drag strip, road course, boat racing lake. It's all here just outside Phoenix. We'll be back after this.
If you're looking for the only midsize 4x4 anywhere, with the upfront power of new V6 fuel injection, and the best truck warranty on or off the road, only one pickup carries that load. It's gotta be the midsize Dodge Dakota.
It's gotta be a Dodge.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
Time Life Music presents the greatest collection of Christmas songs ever assembled.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire.
Now, for the first time, Time Life Music brings you all these great stars together in one Christmas collection. 50 timeless classics on 3 records, 2 long play cassettes, and now on 2 compact discs.
Have a holly jolly Christmas.
Time Life brings you Bing Crosby's White Christmas, the most popular recording of all time. The Treasury of Christmas, the perfect way to celebrate the joy of this holiday season. 50 songs, 3 records, 2 long play cassettes, just $19.95. And now for the first time on 2 compact discs, just $26.95.
Christmas and a happy new year.
Do
order the Time Life Treasury of Christmas, use your credit card and call 1-800-352-2300. If busy, call 1-800-453-2600. Or send $19.95 for LPs or cassettes, or $26.95 for compact discs too. Time Life Christmas, Department 110, Richmond, Virginia.
At the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals at Firebird in Phoenix. Paul Page with Steve Evans as we watch Kim LaHaye packing the parachute for her father, Dick LaHaye, getting ready for the semifinal round in Top Fuel. But right now, it's Top Alcohol Funny Car.
And one of the best in the world, that's Brad Anderson with the roof hatch up. A beautiful automobile. And interestingly enough here, while he is racing Art Hindy, San Bernardino, California, he also trying to get some fresh air in and some tire smoke out. And Hindy uses a Brad Anderson-built power plant, as do a lot of the drivers. Some just buy components from Anderson, cylinder heads and fuel systems. Some buy entire engines. But Anderson is acknowledged as the real true innovator in this particular category. And there you see a crewman lining up Hindy. As I said earlier, you've got to be right on those tracks if you're going to use that burnout to its maximum advantage. So Anderson will be in the far lane. Hindy will be in the near lane. And there you see the polished front wheels moving into the infrared beams that control the staging lights on the Christmas tree. Already, the RPMs are coming up. They hold the cars with handbrake. Hindy with an incredible starting line lead. Hindy with an almost perfect line. Here comes Anderson. Anderson comes up short. That is the upset of the category. Art Hindy at 6:42.22 to Brad Anderson 6:44.219. Now let's look at this one again. The best reaction time we've seen all day in any category. And there are people, Ball, who will tell you can't cut a 0-1 light. In other words, 1/1000th of a second away from a perfect light without gambling. Well, who's to say? But Art Hindy won that one on driving ability and a little bit of an elapsed time edge. Here we see Anderson trying to catch up, giving it all the throttle possible, but a car length short.
Here's Art Hindy, and Art, you got to be happy with that one. That was a whale of a race.
Hey, you better know it was, I'll tell you. Anytime you beat Brad Anderson, you know, you beat the best.
6:40 to a 6:43.
Yeah, well, it was a close race, you know. We were hoping to run a little bit better than that. Oh, still a little nervous, you know. The adrenaline running through you. Yeah.
Into the finals now, thoughts?
Yeah. Hey, we're going to have to find a little bit more for Pat Austin. I'm sure he's going to win this deal, unless he gets crossed up. You know, we're going to have to really find it.
All right, back there and back to work.
Hey, that's it.
Take care.
Hey, thanks a million.
Well, we're about to find out what kind of a prognosticator Art Hindy is, because there is Pat Austin with a smoky, long burnout. And you can get away with that with the alcohol cars, because Chuck Beal, Pat Austin, they don't build as much heat as, let's say, a top fuel racer does on nitro. The alcohol is very cool running fuel. In fact, after a run, if you put your hand on top of the fuel injector, you'll find that it's ice cold. Let's again go to the far end with Paul.
Pat Anderson, boy, you got to know you were in a drag race on that one.
Yeah, it was close, but like I told you last run, we weren't running right. We made a lot of changes, and it picked up 1/100th. That's nothing in ours. We should have picked up 1/10th. That's how far we were off, so we deserve to go home.
You needed the 300s, and it just wasn't there.
It was not there, no matter what I did. I drove it as hard as I could, but it wasn't going to catch him. And he's a good customer of mine, so.
So it works out.
Yeah, I guess.
Take care, man.
Thank you.
Well, you'll never get any excuses from Brad Anderson. He just flat got beat, and he knew it. Well, there's Pat Austin, and Art Hindy says that that's going to be his opponent in the final round. Well, we're about to determine that. Chuck Beal from San Diego, California, he's won a lot of NHRA races. He may have some impact on this whole story. Well, in that Pat Austin has clinched the world championship, they're not racing for any points here, but let's remember they're racing for a sizable chunk of the purse here at the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals, a little traveling money.
Pat Austin, that family team, his father puts the operation together. There you see him seated in the cockpit, already has his world championship wrapped up. So right now he's really racing more for fun and a few bucks than anything else.
Pat Austin adjusting his gloves, trying to get comfortable in that safety harness. He's a big lad. He's wedged into that steel cocoon here in the near lane. A far lane, Chuck Beal. Chuck is ambling up towards the starting line. As I said earlier, heat is not a big problem with these cars, so you'll seldom see what the drivers call a burn down among the alcohol funny cars. You can sit there and run these things until they ran out of fuel, and they probably wouldn't overheat. Beal in the far lane, Pat Austin the favorite in the near lane, staged and ready. Finally is Beal. There's the start. It's Beal away first. Beal has the whole shot. He gets loose in that far lane, as so many have, and Pat Austin thunders
seems to have a stranglehold on this top alcohol funny car competition. Let's take a look at who he'll race in the final round and also another look at the Tonto National Forest. Well, there's a scene right out of Arizona Highways magazine. It will be Pat Austin from the Northwest up against Art Hindy, and Austin has lane choice by an Arizona mile. We're just about ready for the thunder of Top Fuel. The semis are coming up. In fact, Eddie Hill has already strapped himself into the world's fastest Top Fuel dragster. But before we get to that, let's go back down to the far end as Paul Page wraps up the funny car story.
Pat Austin with a 637, 221. Nice easy run there for you.
Yeah, it got a little rough out there. I hit that bump and it seemed to unload the back tires a little bit. There's a bump out there about 60, 80 feet off the starting line. It bounced the back end off the ground. And I saw him as soon as I came out the ground. I saw his front fender again, and then I just shot out, and I didn't see him no more. Good race.
It really was. Looks like the final round's going to be real hot, too.
Going to be a dandy. Going to be a dandy. I was kind of looking forward to racing the OBA, but it doesn't bother me to. These guys are running real well, and they deserve to be in the final right now.
They'll give you a good run.
Oh, you bet.
All
you
right.
bet.
Get to work, then.
Okay, thank you.
Well, BA is Drag Racing Vernacular for Brad Anderson. Well, here comes Gary Ormsby towing up to the starting line area to face off with Eddie Hill. The semifinals of Top Fuel coming up. Stay with us from Phoenix.
Pretty paper.
This year, unwrap pretty the joys of A Christmas with Gusto from blue. Cindy Lou's musical mail order.
Oh, jingle bells, jingle bells.
Bring 20 of the greatest names in country music into your home through this exclusive TV offer. You'll get Tanya Tucker. Merle Haggard.
Going home for Christmas. Coming on a train.
Yes, you and your friends can celebrate with 20 Christmas favorites by such country greats as the Statler Brothers.
Christmas to me is as far as I can see.
And Loretta Lynn.
A good old country Christmas.
Christmas with Gusto is an exceptional collection by the legends of country music like Jim Reeves.
There's an old Christmas card in an old dusty trunk.
And Marty Robbins.
Christmas time.
A total of 20 songs available to you on 8-track LP or cassette. And your satisfaction is completely guaranteed.
There's no place like home.
Dottie West.
I'll have a blue Christmas.
You'll get Johnny Cash.
But may I play for you on my drum.
And Mickey Gilley.
I'll be home. Oh, Christmas.
Christmas with Gusto is a holiday album no collection should be without and would make a lasting Christmas gift.
To order COD or credit card, call toll-free 1-800-255-2000. That's 1-800-255-2000. Or save COD and handling charges by sending $12.95 for LP, 8-track, or cassette 2. Christmas with Gusto, care of TV offer, P.O. Box 10030, Stamford, Connecticut.
Castrol GTX Fall Nationals, the semi-final round of Top Fuel, as we watch Eddie Hill powering the Texan and rolling slowly back to the starting line. He is ready to face Gary Ormsby.
Well, a few weeks ago, Paul, you said Gary Ormsby would be the favorite. He's the quicker of the two cars. Huh, not anymore. Eddie Hill has dropped into those 5-0 elapsed times, as he said, has set the speed record. Right now, I think I would rate Eddie Hill as a favorite here. And he has lane choice. Big advantage today.
Well, he's chosen the near lane. Now, my question is, the near lane has appeared to be good all day. You just heard Pat Austin talk about a bump, though, that seems to be unsettling the cars over in this near lane. The lane choice with a very high temperatures, now over 90 degrees, is really critical here in Phoenix.
Well, that's right. Sometimes one lane will appear to be better than the other just because the good cars take that lane, the ones that have run quicker in the round before. Who's to say? I can tell you it's a great start. Gary Ormsby had an early advantage, a little smoke up the tires of Eddie Hill. Eddie Hill just powers by Ormsby. Amazing. 538, 272 miles per hour. The Ormsby's 547, 262. Ormsby missing by a little less than a tenth of a second.
And here is Joe Amato. This is the fight for the world championship.
Joe Amato versus Dick LaHaye. Now, Amato is in a pretty good position. He's ahead in the points. He would simply like to continue in that position.
Well, I doubt there'll be anyone at the snack bars behind the grandstands as these two get ready to battle, Paul. This should be the race of the day as far as top fuel is concerned. Oh, look at the billowing smoke off the tires of Dick LaHaye, the hardest burnout I have ever seen him make. Right now, Paul is caught up with Eddie Hill.
Eddie Hill, a 538, 272. You look nice and clean into the final round.
Looks pretty good. I'm sure proud to be here.
You see some smoke off the tires?
Could be. It didn't seem like it did quite its normal thing all the way through, so it may have broken them loose just a little bit. If so, I don't know where it was, but it felt like it was a little soft maybe the first third of the track.
Who will race Eddie Hill in the final? Will it be Joe Amato with his wife Jerry in front of the car, or will it be Dick LaHaye? Earlier, Paul asked both drivers how they approached this race.
Well, we're probably going to have to step up to run a low 530, maybe a high 520. And I think the reaction time on the start line is going to be real critical, whoever leaves first. So, you know, we're just going to try and put our motor together and make it run good and go out and see and give it our best shot, you know. It's a lot of $100,000 on the table for the world championship, but it's not really over after this race, even if we lost, because it would just make it real tight for the next race. If we win, it would just about ice it. So, it's a pivotal point, but it's not the end of the world. So, you know, we're just going to do our best job and go out there and try and win. You know, it's going to be anybody's race. It's going to be a tight one. Every time me and LaHaye run, they're always 100, 200 apart, you know, either way. So, just right. Give them my best job.
Well, we'd like to put the same kind of question to Dick LaHaye, but as you can see, he is down underneath the engine of that top fuel dragster, trying to make sure that it's ready to do everything that it needs to do in this semifinal round. Now, he, of course, has lane choice here, and he is after his first world title. So the situation perhaps just a little bit more critical here in the LaHaye pits. Either way, the race will go on for the world championship and will be settled at Pomona, California.
But if Joe Amato should beat Dick LaHaye here, it'll be a tremendous setback for LaHaye. It will put him almost three rounds of racing behind with only one race to go to make that up. There is Joe Amato. Near lane, Dick LaHaye. This is a repeat of the final round of the U.S. Nationals when Amato got the whole shot and beat LaHaye's quicker lap time. They're moving up in staging. All eyes on the starting line here at Firebird International Raceway. And off the mark versus Amato. A brilliant lead with the far lane by Joe Amato. Amato is ahead. The wind light says LaHaye. Electronically, the race has been judged. Dick LaHaye the winner at 5.28 to Amato's 5.32. But Amato had 400s right off the mark. In the far lane, Amato left first, a brilliant light. So if you do the mathematics on this, it is theoretically almost a dead heat. And again, we take a look as they cross the finish line stripe. He won it by about a foot.
I'm very happy Dick LaHaye finally gets the helmet off. You ready, my friend? 5.28, 2.74, and you have lane choice. You're moving closer.
Well, Paul, I'll tell you what. I can almost cry right now. We've been trying to win this thing all year. And let me catch my breath here just for a second. I feel like I've run it. I'm
taking his breath completely away. Here's Joe Amato.
It's a drag race.
Thank you very much.
Okay. See you the winner.
Well, Paul, you know, this has been a tough year for us. We have been just up and down and up and down. We was down coming into this race. And I bet Kim and Jeff are just out of control right now. I mean, I'm scared.
You were down under the car yourself in between rounds there. Were there any problems?
I do that every round. That's how we tune the engine, is off the bottom end.
Don't do that.
Well, we have to do that. I'll tell you, I'm so thrilled. If we can win this, we can pull closer to the world championship. And we just hope we can.
You're on your way.
Thank you very much, right, Paul.
Well, they say there's horses for courses. Well, Dick LaHaye owns Firebird. He won this race a year ago as well. In Tahoe National Forest again, you see the beautiful Canyon Lake. And we see that Dick LaHaye indeed does have lane choice over Eddie Hill in the top fuel final confrontation. And the most interested spectator of them all will be Joe Amato.
I'm sure you had to know you were in a drag race there.
Yeah, we were ahead right before the first light, you know, and the heat came by me. My motor must have burned up a little bit. And we knew we were going to have a shootout, 28 to 31, but We're still ahead. If we hold top speed and low ET, we'll be 150 points ahead going into the World Finals, and it's going to be a shootout there.
But this was your chance, really, to get away.
Yeah, this is my chance to put it away and not have to have that pressure on me at the World Finals. But, you know, that's what a true champion is made out of, someone who can hold the pressure, I guess.
Pressure's there, and you can handle it.
We'll have to just learn how.
All right,
okay,
thanks.
Thank you.
Don't be surprised if you find Joe Amato or his crew chief Tim Richards over at the Eddie Hill trailer saying you need any help, and he parts up on a whole motor. Well, here's Butch Leal. He's already coming into the lanes for the Pro Stock semifinals. They're up next.
If you're into high-performance cars or off-the-road sports trucks or just a mechanic who likes to work in his own garage, then we've got a brand new show just for you. Hi, I'm Tim Horn.
And I'm Alan Westbrook. Join us and Deborah Rogers every Sunday to see what's hot in performance and styling products for your vehicle on the all-new Auto Specialty Magazine Show.
Sports Sundays at 3:30 p.m. Eastern, 12:30 p.m. Pacific on TNN.
Diamond P's NHRA Championship Drag Racing 87. All the action, all the records, all the color in one non-stop 80-minute action-packed video. It's Diamond P's Drag Racing 87, just in time for Christmas. Garlitz takes Pomona by storm. Bernstein routs the Aussies. Finally, John Forrest wins a funny car title, and LaHaye makes it three in a row. Amato takes Indy. Bernstein's car burns to the ground and is resurrected all in one race. Mike Dunn goes 280. Amato's Bueller goes 287. Glidden runs 191 and a pro stocker. Gwynn cuts a 508, and the records continue to fall. This is it, the tape of all seasons for the NHRA season of all seasons, Diamond P's Drag Racing 87. To get your copy of Drag Racing 87 in time for Christmas, call 1-800-826-6868 or send a check or money order to this address. Drag Racing 87, just $39.95 plus $3.50 shipping and handling. Visa and MasterCard accepted. Please specify VHS or Beta. Celebrate Christmas in the fast lane. Call 1-800-826-6868 now.
It's a massive crowd here in Phoenix at the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals of the NHRA, and we are ready for the semifinal round in Pro Stock. First up will be Butch Leal as he faces Warren Johnson.
And here we see Leal with his hand on the first gear lever. He pulls that to the shift from first to second. But right now he's got his finger on a little button that electronically locks the front wheels and enables him to do that kind of almost stationary burnout. And there is Warren Johnson doing exactly the same thing. Now, as these Pro Stock cars have gotten faster, and by fast I mean 190 miles per hour, both Bob Glidden and Warren Johnson have topped that mark. They're getting harder and harder to stop. So, the Pro Stock crews have investigated some new materials as far as brakes are concerned. Paul took a look earlier.
You know, more and more in motorsports, we see the inclusion of space-age development coming into the cars themselves. Stuff like honeycomb aluminum and carbon fiber in the race cars. Here's a development in disc brakes that makes a world of difference. Now, this is an old cast alloy disc brake as opposed to the new carbon system. Now, the situation here is a comparison of both weight and effectiveness. In the old cast system, this weighs about 11 pounds, and as you can see, it is very heavy as opposed to the carbon at 2 pounds. Also, this can continue braking no matter how much heat is actually being radiated from the braking process. So much heat, in fact, that the center aluminum section will actually melt while the disc is continuing to give braking action to the car. Now, obviously, there is a very important difference in the weight in that we're talking unsprung weight. That is that this, being much lighter, is also much easier to get rolling. So it makes a world of difference in overall speed. Now, do you want some of these? Right here, about $80. If you really want carbon, $800.
And the drivers tell me you've got to be careful when you first get a set of those brakes because they're so powerful you can lock up the front wheels using the same foot pressure. There's Warren Johnson. He's checking everything inside that car, making sure that the levers are all in the right positions as he moves in to the infrared beams to face off with Butch Leal. If you're a regular viewer of NHRA Championship Drag Racing, you know the story about Butch Leal. He is cat quick off of the starting line. This is the semifinals in Pro Stock. And off the mark first it is Butch Leal. Leal with a close out of about 400ths of a second. But here comes Johnson, and he comes up short. Butch Leal wins it, goes to the final round with a 758, 183 mile per hour charge.
as compared to Johnson's 764, 183 miles per hour. Now, who will Butch Leal race in the final? Will it be Darrell Alderman heating up the tires on his Camaro from Illinois? Or will it be the bright red Ford Thunderbird of Bob Glidden? I'm sure if Butch had a choice, he'd pick Alderman instead of the quicker every round Bob Glidden. Paul?
And Butch Leal climbs out on his way now to the final round, 758-184, Butch.
Yeah, they're a little better. We worked on the clutch, and they just scraped the track, and I was real nervous about that. You know how that goes, because we have the track conditioned the same every day, every round. And now we caught it, and they scraped it right in the middle of our round. I said, oh, no, I don't know what the car's going to do. And it worked pretty, obviously, it worked pretty well. I don't know what Warren ran then, but I made a decent run at this time of day.
Looks like you got away good, too.
I got away. I made a good start, and that's what's important now, as you know. And here comes a good race we're going to have now, and I don't know who I'll have in the final, but I'm glad to be here.
Alderman Glidden, one of the others.
That's one of the others, and they're both excellent racers.
Let's go back to the line and find out.
Let's find out. Thank you.
They are both pre-staged. Alderman inching forward into the staging beams. I'm sure Glidden will do likewise. Neither driver playing any games whatsoever. Ford versus Chevrolet. And it is Bob Glidden with the start of his life. Bob Glidden in perfect light. Alderman is not even in the hunt. Rusty Glidden says, all right, Dad. Bob Glidden, 754, 184 miles per hour, to Darrell Alderman's 165. It's obvious to me that Glidden is just getting sick and tired of being left on by the Leals and the Aldermans, and he is playing hardball. So Bob Glidden will have lane choice in the Pro Stock Final when he faces off with the Trans Am of Butch Leal.
So the final rounds in all categories coming up. And as we take a look back in the pit area, that's Eddie Hill's pit, as they work on the Texan preparing that car to face Dick LaHaye. Final rounds will be coming up from the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals here in Phoenix, Arizona.
Oh, my arm.
Rub something on it.
I got Bengay, but I don't want to go back to work smelling like Bengay.
Don't. Try Sports Cream. It smells nice and clean.
Does it work?
Massaging Sports Cream in brings fast relief for pain. It starts to soothe sore muscles immediately.
No workout today?
Sure. I feel great. Why?
You usually smell like Bengay.
Not anymore.
Sports Cream, the fast-acting pain-relieving rub that smells great.
If your car is trying to tell you it wants something, come to Kmart and pick up a pair of ANCO wiper blades or refills for better visibility.
Nice car. Want some more?
Kmart, America's favorite store.
Everyone's going ape in October with the biggest hit music from country's brightest stars. Bust Loose with the O'Kanes, nominated for 4 Country Music Awards and featuring 3 top 10 singles. Turn on hit after hit with Ricky Van Shelton's monster debut album, Wild Eye Dream. And hold on tight for 5 smash singles from Sweethearts of the Rodeo.
This week, Kenny and Donna Price take you to the high country as they RV their way through Yellowstone National Park. Along the way, you'll stop at the gallery and workshop of renowned sculptor Harvey Ratty and relive the past on a visit to a museum filled with Indian and archaeological artifacts. Then get into the fun of cross-country skiing and snowmobiling deep into the heart of Yellowstone. It's a great way to get away. Wish you were here. Sunday at 4:30 Eastern, 1:30 p.m. Pacific on TNN.
When you're hungry for something different, tune to the Nashville Network, where you'll find super performances, the latest news, the hottest videos by me, Vince Gill, and other top entertainers. The Nashville Network is definitely the place to be for hot country.
Hi, I'm Darrell Walters. We take our country seriously on TNN.
The power of the top fuel dragster, and it all ends up right here as Kim and Dick LaHaye take a look at those giant rear Goodyears on his top fuel dragster. But it's time for the final round in Pro Stock. Butch Leal fires it up, brings it out of the box, making sure those tires are perfectly clean because he's got to face the grand champion, Bob Glidden.
Well, this has been the two-car battle all year long. Occasionally, a Bruce Allen or Warren Johnson steps up into the limelight, but these are really the two cars the fans have been following. Bleel got a great start the early part of the year. He led the points. Glidden struggled. All of a sudden, he and Etta and the family found out whatever ingredient was missing, and all of a sudden, as we told you before, the Thunderbird took over and is dominating. I believe this was like the 19th straight race that Glidden has qualified number one. And Glidden kind of threw the gauntlet 2 weeks ago in Dallas, Texas, when he just looked right into the camera and said, I'm tired of these guys beating up on me on the starting line, and I can drive. And I'll tell you, he has proven it today. That last round, Glidden had almost a perfect life, the best one he's ever cut in his life. And that's got to tell Butch Leal that maybe that advantage that he once held over Glidden is gone.
Glidden is driving amazingly well. In the last round, you saw it. He cut a light within 5/1000ths of a second to perfect. Now, with Bob Glidden in the near lane, Butch Leal in the far lane, we are on the line for the final round in Pro Stock. Engine revs begin to come up. Both drivers watching the tree.
And neither wants to stage first. It's Glidden that breaks. Glidden moves in. Now he is followed by Leal.
.759/182 to .759/184 miles per hour. Bob Glidden is the Pro Stock champion. He had already clinched the world championship and even passed the points column four here. Let's take another look. The red car in the near lane reacts to the lights first. You actually leave when you see that yellow. If you wait for green, you are late. Glidden came off the starting line with an advantage. Leal appeared to make up for some of that deficit that he lost off the line. At half track, it was Glidden by a car length, and he extended that even more as they neared the 13-20 strike. Glidden in the near lane, extending his advantage over Butch Leal. It is Bob Glidden winning it.
Bob Glidden just keeps chalking him up this season. Bob, terrific little fight down there in the lights, though.
No, not really. You know, Butch does his thing on the starting line. I do mine. I figured that I'd have to stage first, and I was just taking my time, trying to get myself mentally ready. No, not really. No fight. I mean, we race almost every race. Can I get Butch in here?
Sure.
Come on in here,
Butch.
Hey, good race.
Hey, you did a good job.
Bobby, you were a 749-182.9.
The track is a little bit on the short side, and I thought I was far enough ahead. I've been having a little bit of trouble with the parachute stopping, so I clicked it about the ET light.
Butch, he's awful good, isn't he?
Oh, he's excellent. He's one of the toughest competitors there is in all drag racing. As a matter of fact, I was just thinking of maybe all racing, and we've been racing battling each other all year, and I think that we're pretty close to being 1-2 this year, and we've had a great time, and I'm just looking forward to doing it again. We've got one more race left, and that time I tried to let him stage, and I was going to wait for him, mess myself up, and he killed me on a tree.
Bob Glidden wins it. Butch Leal is the runner-up, and that's the kind of camaraderie that you see in Pro Stock. It's what makes the category great, Steve.
I couldn't agree more, Paul. Just two great competitors who obviously have a good deal of respect for each other. Here is the alcohol funny car final round, and I'll tell you one guy who's got to be pleased with his performance, win or lose, and that is Art Hendy, San Bernardino, California. This is the farthest in NHRA national event competition he has ever gone. Now, he'll be racing the red, white, and green machine of Pat Austin. The world champion, he's already amassed more points than anyone else. No one can catch him in that category, but he can pick up a very nice paycheck with one more winning dash.
Well, there's no question that the pressure here is really on Art Hendy as we take a look at his machine. He's never been this far. He's facing a fellow who is obviously very, very good, a team that is extraordinarily strong. He's already the world champion. Hendy, though, if he could win this round, really makes a name for himself.
And let's remember Hendy's reaction time earlier. He and Bob Glidden have the two best reaction times, regardless of class, the whole day. Both of them very close to a perfect light. And you can bet that Pat Austin is aware of that. His team is keeping track of what the opposition is up to.
The odds would seem to additionally go, though, to Pat Austin because he's using the near lane. That's where the wins have been coming from. But remember that Austin said he hit a hump about 90 to 100 feet out last time, and it really unsettled the car, made him nervous.
Well, it's not so much a bump, it's the seam where the concrete launch pad meets the asphalt drag strip. A lot of tracks have that problem. But Pat Austin feels that a little bit of bump is not worth going over into that other lane. Austin in the near lane, Art Hendy in the far lane. Can Hendy be the giant killer? Oh, the wheels are way up in the air. Hendy loses control. Just bump the throttle. Pat Austin hits the bump. The car starts weaving around.
Sioux at about 65 miles per hour. So Pat Austin, he's been the dominant alcohol clinic car all year, and nothing changed here. Again, let's take a look. But watch the far car, Art Hindy. The front wheels came up higher than they have all day. Now, you know, he can see the horizon change. He backpedaled, set him down, but when he did, the car headed towards the wall. Hindy wisely got off the pedal before he had to buy a new fiberglass body. And here into the staging lanes comes the long white Texan car with the stars down the nose. Eddie Hill's wife, Ursi, the cheerleader of the team, steering the car into the lanes. Let's go down to the far end and Paul.
Well, here's Pat Austin. World championship year. Nice run there. Hindy had to shut it down. You're running through with a 6:39.219.
I hit that bump again and threw the back end off the ground. And I got out of shape and I was waiting to see him. And, you know, when you hit that bump like that, it just throws away everything you worked for on the clutch on the car because it changes everything, you know. You're just hoping for a good, smooth run. I had a short shift because of that bump, so that's where the ET went. But without Castro, it wouldn't be possible.
Still, it's a fall nationals title, isn't it? And what a place to do it.
To win the world championship and win this many races in 1 year, I mean, I'm going through a year. Team's going through a year that you just can't forget, and I'm very happy for Castro Motor Oil, standard of performance. That's what makes this baby run.
The rest of the gang just dreams about these kind of seasons. Congratulations, man.
Thank you very much. Thanks, guys.
Well, 500 cars began this race 3 days ago. Now only two remain, the kings of the sport, the Top Fuel Final. Can Dick LaHaye continue to erode the points lead of Joe Amato?
You're about to experience a whole new feeling. New Shure with Desert Spice Scent. If you'll go with the feeling, it'll add new spice to your life.
Shure deodorant, now available in the new Desert Spice Scent, salutes Pat Austin, this week's Shure winner of the week. Austin was the class of the field in his top alcohol funny car at the NHRA Fall Nationals in Phoenix.
Yes, Mrs. Ferber, I'll be right over.
What's up?
It's Alex. He's been burying things in Mrs. Ferber's garden again.
Right here. Mm-hmm. Alex, a bottle of Stroh's.
Keep digging.
Mm-hmm. Nice, Alex. 15-pack.
Keep digging.
With Stroh's and Stroh Light 15 and 30 packs, you get more beer.
How did he get a whole truck down there?
Why don't we ask the driver?
If you're looking for the only mid-sized pickup in America, with the heart of a full-size and the spirit of a compact, with available new V6 fuel injection up front, room in back for a full sheet of plywood, and covered by the best truck warranty in the business, it's gotta be the midsize Dodge Dakota.
It's gotta be a Dodge! Oh, yeah!
If your car is trying to tell you it wants something, come to Kmart and get the Amercept Carvac with extension brush attachment and removable dust bag.
Nice car. Want some more?
Kmart, America's favorite store.
Today's small cars are tougher than ever on oil. Their high compression engines not only rev high, they can run hotter than regular small car engines. Their searing heat can begin to break down an oil immediately. That's why there's Castrol, the only leading motor oil that in every grade provides maximum protection against viscosity and thermal breakdown. So use Castrol before your engine does something to get you heated up. Castrol, engineered for today's smaller cars.
Okay, last time. This is drugs. This is your brain on drugs. Any questions?
It's the final round of Top Fuel at the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals in Phoenix, Arizona. All paved with Steve Evans as Dick LaHaye pours the power to his Top Fuel dragster, ready to take on Eddie Hill.
And, Paul, we've talked all day about lane choice being a big advantage. Well, it was during the heat of the day. As you can see, the lights are on, the sun is setting here in Arizona, and I don't feel lane choice is quite as big a deal as it was. Look at the nitro flames licking at the wing on Eddie Hill's car. Those are present in the daytime. You just can't see them. Now, the flames on Lahaye's car are not nearly as obvious. In fact, almost non-existent because they run a totally different fuel system. Now, on the burnout, Eddie Hill has the car ripped so that it doesn't hurt itself. Before he goes to the line, he will grab a lever and he will lean down that fuel system.
Now, Dick Lahaye, still in pursuit of a world championship against Joe Amato, really needs these points. As we look at Eddie Hill, there are the flames. Steve just mentioned them. But Dick Lahaye is in the lane that has produced all the wins in the final rounds. Will it do it again? Eddie Hill motors that car up to the line. Dick Lahaye idling as well, waiting for the start.
This is the third opportunity this season Eddie Hill has had to win his first ever NHRA national event. He's come up short twice, would certainly like to finally get into the win column. The tiny front wheels on Eddie Hill's car in the far lane. Dick Lahaye in the near lane. There's 200 valuable world championship points for Dick Lahaye if he can win here. And look at this as they thunder down the quarter of a mile. A good start by both drivers. It is Dick Lahaye by what appears to be less than a car length. 5.26 to a 5.33. 274 for Lahaye, 276 for Eddie Hill. And Joe Amato right now is walking back to his trailer with not a hint of a smile. Let's take a look one more time. The growth of the header flames tell you that Dick Lahaye reacted first. By 2/100ths of a second, he had the advantage over Eddie Hill. But at this point, in his peripheral vision, you know Dick Lahaye could see that white car from Texas. But now, he no longer sees it as he crosses the finish line a car length ahead.
Dick Lahaye said it as he begins to pull the helmet off now. One whale of a weekend, Dick, a 5.26 with a 2.75 as he takes home the title here at the Fall Nationals. And I know your heart has been thumping the entire weekend long.
Well, I'll tell you what, Paul. This whole weekend has just been out of control. You know, we come in here and we was kind of struggling qualifying. We ended up qualifying number three, which I shouldn't complain about that. And then Joe was running so well, and he's got the quickest and fastest car, you know, and it just... things just fall into place, and the Lord is watching over us, I guess. And we started running those ETs, and it ran four quick runs, and good enough to win the race.
And moving a little closer toward a championship crown, too.
Well, now we're less than a round behind him. If he should go out a round before we do it the next race, we could win this world championship. You know, and it just, one thing I've got to do, and I've got to do this. Castrol GTX puts this race on every year. I have won every one of their races in the last 2 years, four of them in a row. And John Gardella is going to be out of control.
Great for you, great for them. What a great day.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, Dick Lahaye.
Dick talking about John Gardella, the racing director for Castrol. And Dick, I've got to agree, it's been a whale of a weekend. In pro stock, Bob Glidden won his seventh race of the season. And Pat Austin proved why he is the top alcohol funny car world champion. And of course, Dick Lahaye won top fuel. Well, right now, Paul is with the man that Dick Lahaye had to beat for the title here today in Phoenix.
Well, Eddie Hill, it looked like you were closing down on him toward the end.
It seemed like we were, too, but we ran out of room. I think we ran a little faster. It felt like we did.
Well, you were definitely running faster, a 5.32 with a 2.76 to his 2.75 through the traps.
We were pulling on him a little, but it waited too late to do it. What were the two ETs?
He came through with a 5.26. You're at a 5.32.
Well, did we haze the tires out in the mid-range again like we've been doing?
I wish we could tell from down here.
I couldn't tell. Well, we gave it a good shot. We ran good. Ran pretty fast.
Yeah. Congratulations.
Oh, sorry, babe. We didn't win.
Had good speed.
Yeah, really. Well, they knew we were here.
Yeah, they did. Good.
Eddie Hill, runner-up, top fuel at the Fall Nationals. Steve?
Thank you, Paul, and so long, everyone, from Phoenix.
The executive producer of American Sports Cavalcade is Harvey M. Balish. The supervising producer is John...